So today we'll be talking about basically variants of stochastic gradient descent, right? So first I'll introduce the stochastic gradient descent algorithm and then talk about a few variants of stochastic gradient descent. So the first part will be focused on kind of the focus of SGD for like convex problems. So mainly we'll talk about, so we'll talk about things like convergence analysis. Etc. Right, and also I'll talk about one variant of stochastic gradient descent and also related algorithms that people have been studying recently, which kind of tries to combine the ideas of SGD and gradient descent. Okay, so I think this lecture will kind of focus on the intuitions of stochastic gradient descent, convergence rates, etc. And then the second part, which is lecture 6.2. Will focus mostly on today how SGD is being used for deep learning, right? So we'll talk about basically, sorry. So this is like applications to deep learning. Okay, so all right. So the outline here is we'll do a quick recap of gradient descent, right? And then we'll get to stochastic gradient descent, in particular talk about some of the intuitions of stochastic gradient descent, right? And we'll kind of also talk about convergence rates, and then we'll talk about some hybrid approaches, which is like combining SGD and gradient descent, right? So this part will actually be lecture 6.2. Right, so this is lecture 6.1. So this is the first part. Okay. So far this is the standard convex optimization problem which we have been looking at, right? So we try to optimize, or we try to minimize a function f of x subject to x being within the constraint capital X, right? So capital X here is a convex set and x is the optimization variable. This is an unconstrained problem if capital X is equal to the domain of f, right? So a lot of machine learning optimization problems fit into this framework. We actually saw several of these in the previous slides, right? I mean the previous lectures. So in particular, we looked at this kind of important family of algorithms called gradient descent, right? And then through the next, I mean, through the last few lectures, we have been looking at either variants of gradient descent or variants of like second order methods, which are like Hessian style algorithms, quasi-Newton or quasi-Hessian based algorithms, right? BFGS, etc., LBFGS, and then we also saw conjugate gradient descent. So in some sense, it's either gradient based or it's like second order information, right? And these are all kind of analytical algorithms, kind of numerical algorithms, right? We are not trying to solve the problem in closed form. This is in the case where we can't solve the problem in closed form, right? So in some sense, it's like you start with like the best case scenario is just solve in closed form if possible, right? Solve in closed form. So a few things can be solved in closed form, right? Example, linear regression. Right, but linear regression itself is problematic, right? Because this involves matrix inversion, kind of involves computing the Hessian, storing the Hessian, etc. All of this is kind of matrix, like basically matrix multiplication time, or it's like order, kind of order n cubed, roughly speaking, right? Or like order d cubed, d is the dimensionality. So this is possible in some cases, but it's mostly problematic, right? So that's why you kind of go to the next stage where you actually do solve in gradient descent or its variants, right? So these are all full gradient descent, right? And this is actually pretty powerful here. So you have like all of these algorithms, like gradient descent, accelerated gradient descent, conjugate gradient descent, etc. Right? And then you have this variant where you can kind of use second order information. Right? So basically quasi-Newton methods. Right? So there they are using kind of little bit more information. So this is, in some sense, this is kind of in between these two. Right? So this falls in between these two. But then you can, what we'll be looking at today is to actually go one step beyond this, right? And assume that, you know, even computing the full gradient is difficult, right? So that is where we are trying to look at essentially the paradigm of stochastic gradients. Okay, so anyway, we'll kind of look at this, but I just want to give this kind of in the bigger picture right now, right? All right, so the gradient descent is essentially an iterative algorithm, right? Where you compute this gradient and then you multiply a learning rate or a step size, right? So gamma is a step size parameter, which needs to be set appropriately. And then the critical question from a mathematical perspective, right? Or a computational perspective is how much time does it take to reach an epsilon approximate solution, right? So essentially the way this is done is that you define X star to be a global minimizer of F and you make certain assumptions on F, right? So either F is Lipschitz continuous or F is smooth or F is strongly convex and so on and so forth, right? So essentially we saw that the way you can measure this is by kind of computing a F of X minus F of X star, right? Less than equal to epsilon and the question, so we call this xt, right? So xt is the solution of the tth iteration, right? So the question is, can we compute, so how many iterations is required for the above, right? So to achieve a solution which is less than equal to epsilon, the question is how many iterations t do we require, right? So this is the kind of principal computational question we have been looking at in the last few lectures. And this is known, right? So we have seen basically several proof techniques that kind of study this in detail for a number of kind of convex optimization problems. So, and also settings, right? So if you have Lipschitz continuous functions, then you have kind of a convergence rate of r square b square over epsilon square, right? So this is also noted as one over order one over epsilon square, right? Because r and b are constants. If you assume is Lipschitz continuous plus strongly convex, right? Then you have this 2b square over epsilon, roughly speaking, right? So it's order one over epsilon now. If it's smooth functions, also you have order one over epsilon. So both of these are roughly the same, except that this one is in terms of the smoothness, Lipschitz smoothness parameter. This one is in terms of the Lipschitz continuity parameter, right? But otherwise, in terms of, if you kind of remove the constants aside, in terms of the convergence, in terms of epsilon, they are both the same. They are both order one over epsilon, right? And then you have Nesterov's method, which we saw that actually improves the 1 over epsilon to square root 1 over epsilon, right? So this is in some sense optimal, at least in the smooth case, right? This is optimal in the general case, right? In the Lipschitz continuous case, but in the smooth case, this is optimal. And then we saw that with strongly convex functions, we can achieve L over mu. So this is also called kappa. If you see some talks which talk about this, right, this is also called kappa or the condition number. So it's basically kappa times log one over epsilon, roughly speaking, right? You kind of remove constants if you remove the constants aside. But kappa is this important quantity. Right. And also you can kind of come up with a Nesterov's version of this. Where, so I'll just write this down for completeness. So Nesterov, which is the accelerated gradient descent version, this gives like square root of L over mu log R square L over epsilon or something like that, right? The main point is that this reduces this constant that is there upfront from kappa to square root kappa. Yeah, so there's a question. Is the condition number relating to the difference between the max and the min? What do you mean by the difference between max and the min? Like the range. No. So the condition number, so here L, right? L is actually the Lipschitz smoothness parameter and mu is the strong convexity parameter, right? So if you recall, we have this kind of nice relationship, right? So we have the fact that the strong convexity means you actually have a quadratic kind of lower bound, right? So basically given a convex function like this, we have a lower bound of this convex function, right? Which is this strong convexity, right? And this is basically mu, strongly convex, right? So that means that there is this quadratic lower bound dependent on mu, right? And similarly, you also have a quadratic upper bound now, right? Which depends on L. Right, so essentially what this means is that this convex function is essentially quadratic, right? But mu is this lower bound and L is this upper bound, right? So in other words, what you can show is that if you have the Hessian, right? If you have the Hessian of the function, right? At xt, at any x actually, then this Hessian actually will be bounded by L times I. So basically L is the upper bound, right? And this is lower bounded by mu times I, right? So mu essentially can be thought of like the quadratic lower bound on this function and L is this upper bound, right? So essentially these are two important parameters that kind of determine the function, right? So think of it like, you know, something like logistic regression. Okay, so logistic regression, you have like the logistic loss, which is smooth, right? So you have the logistic loss of x plus some regularizer by 2 of x square, right? So this regularizer lambda, this is the strong convexity parameter, right? So essentially, since L is not strongly convex, if L is a logistic regression, L is not strongly convex, right? L is just smooth. So the strong convexity kind of naturally comes from this lambda, right? Essentially, so this is mu, right? So lambda is equal to mu over here, okay? And the the smoothness depends on L. So the smoothness basically depends on I think the minimum eigenvalue of the matrix AA transpose or something like that, right? So essentially what this means is that you can actually, I don't think it's the minimum eigenvalue. I think in the case of a linear regression, right? In the case of a linear regression, the Lipschitz smoothness is the maximum eigenvalue and the strong convexity parameter is the minimum eigenvalue, right? But in the case of just standard logistic regression, then again, the Lipschitz continuity depends on the loss function L and the strong convexity depends on mu, right? Does that answer your question? Yeah, sure. So essentially kappa, the condition number, is this ratio between the Lipschitz smoothness. This is the ratio of the Lipschitz smoothness term versus the strong convexity. And you're right. So when you are looking at just linear regression, right? In linear regression, it's kind of nice because you just have a function which is essentially quadratic, right? And there you can exactly kind of articulate this condition number, and it turns out to be related to the minimum and the maximum eigenvalues, I believe. I'll double check and get back to you on this. But yeah, so essentially dependent based on those parameters, you can actually come up with this kappa, right? Yes, Nathan.
So the eigenvalues in reference to which matrix?
So the data matrix, right? So you have the matrix A. So essentially linear regression is like L of W, which is like a times w minus b square or something like that, right? So this is going to be, so A need not be a square matrix, but you can do like A transpose A, right? And A transpose A will be a square matrix. And essentially you compute the minimum and maximum eigenvalues of A transpose A.
Okay.
Yeah, in fact, I had shared that video. Do look at that video actually. At least the first part will be very interesting because you can kind of connect back to the results. So he actually gives a good recap of the results in the case of the linear regression, right? And you'll see that a lot of the stuff that we spoke about, he actually talks about in that video as well. So this is actually a video by Shyam Kakade, and it's actually kind of a nice talk on kind of accelerating stochastic gradient descent algorithms, but it kind of talks about the gradient descent regime as well a little bit. Yeah, are there any other questions? Okay, so it turns out that in machine learning, right, we are not looking at any arbitrary convex loss, right? We are looking at a very special kind of loss functions, okay? And the special kind of loss functions comes from the fact that all of our loss functions are essentially finite sum of individual number of components, right? So you have a sum of a large number of components, and this n is finite, right? So essentially you have fi is the cost function or the loss function of the ith observation, right? Or the ith data point in your training. And n is the total number of training data points, right? So essentially like from the machine learning literature, if you've taken a machine learning course, you will see that essentially fi of theta is equal to L of xi comma yi comma theta, right? So this is the loss function on the individual data point xi, yi, right? And then you can actually compute the full gradient. But the problem here is that the full gradient requires an order n. So it requires going through the entire data set to compute the full gradient, right? Now, the problem is that n is actually of the order of a million to hundreds of millions to actually even a billion data points, right? So these days when deep models are trained on, you know, kind of massive data sets, it's kind of not uncommon today in industry to have, you know, billions of examples, and you just basically kind of have a deep model learn on this, right? In fact, even a lot of non-deep learning is also done at the scale of billions of data points, right? So you really need to think about kind of scaling your optimization to that regime. And obvious limitation of gradient descent is this fact that, you know, you need to, just to compute one gradient, you need to do this very, very expensive step, right, of evaluating order n data points, okay? So kind of this gives the intuition of stochastic gradient descent, okay? So stochastic gradient descent kind of runs as follows, right? So you sample an index I uniformly at random, and you just compute the gradient of the ith instance, right? So you do xt plus 1 is equal to xt minus gamma t times fi of xt, okay? So here, this is the times kind of index t from 0 to whatever, gamma t is the step size, right? So the idea here is that you are, so in standard gradient descent, you have gradient of f, right, in gradient descent. But in SGD, you are dealing with the gradient of each example at a time. Okay, so this is the main difference. And each iteration here of SGD is obviously order n times cheaper than full gradient descent, right? Why is this order n times cheaper? Well, because computing delta f or the gradient of f requires taking a sum over I from 1 to n, whereas here you're just taking it for one I, right? The intuition here is that this vector gt is a stochastic gradient, right? So the reason why it's stochastic, the stochasticity comes from the fact that we are sampling this index uniformly at random, right? So because you're sampling this index uniformly at random, essentially, when you're kind of analyzing this, as we'll see, we need to analyze this in expectation, right? Because it's a randomized algorithm. So unlike the standard gradient descent, Stochastic gradient descent actually is a randomized algorithm. So this is one kind of key difference here. Okay, so that's the reason why GT is a random variable, right? Essentially, yeah. So the vector of D random variables, but we just call it a random variable, right? So this is how we want to analyze stochastic gradient descent. Any questions until now? Yeah, okay. So so how many iterations? So what do you mean by how many iterations? You mean like so the number of iterations is something that you set typically upfront, right? So just like how you set in gradient descent, you set this in stochastic gradient descent. So there's one caveat typically. So typically in deep learning, right? In deep learning, the intuition is that when you're doing one epoch, so one epoch is one pass through the entire data, right? And then in machine learning, you kind of count the number of epochs, right? So you run this for say 200, 300 epochs. So from that perspective, stochastic gradient descent is slightly analogous to gradient descent, but there's one key difference, right? And we'll actually kind of study the key differences in the next few slides to understand exactly why stochastic gradient descent is why it's really the de facto algorithm today, you know, for like several machine learning problems. So there's actually a very good reason, and we'll actually look at it. Yeah, so we'll also talk about batch AGD. So yeah, we'll actually be coming to a lot of that. So does I change to the algorithm or is it fixed? Yeah, so this is actually at every time step, right? So here we do for t is equal to 1 to capital T. So I'll keep capital T here as a number of iterations, right, of say SGD, right? So here, we are not yet talking about batch SGD, right? So batch stochastic gradient descent is something we are not yet talking about. Right now, we are just talking about I being a single example. Okay, yeah, so I is not a batch. I is a simple example which we are sampling at random. And once you sample a I, you do this update on I. Okay. So essentially, this is the for loop over here, right? So for, and then here you say have end for. Okay, so this is basically the pseudocode. Okay, so I run it for capital T number of iterations. And in each iteration, I sample I uniformly at random. And then I do this update, right? So every iteration, the I is changing. So to answer your question, Joshua, I is changing at every iteration because I am randomly sampling from n, one example I. Does that answer your question? Okay. So the problem with SGD is coordinate descent also stochastic? Yeah, so we spoke about coordinate descent last time. So coordinate descent is different because in coordinate descent, we are not picking one example at a time randomly. We are picking one feature or one coordinate at a time, right? And yes, you're right. There is this randomized coordinate descent, which we spoke about, if you remember, right, Athresh? So we spoke about randomized coordinate descent, and that is akin to stochastic gradient descent because that algorithm also is randomized. We are at random picking a coordinate, but there is also this greedy coordinate descent variant, right? That we spoke about where, you know, you are doing it greedily and that is actually not randomized, but yeah, there is a variant of coordinate descent that is randomized and stochastic, right? But the key difference between coordinate descent and stochastic gradient descent is a coordinate descent is picking one example one coordinate at a time, right? Or one feature at a time. But in SGD, we are picking one data instance at a time. Okay, so that's like a key difference to keep in mind. Okay, so the problem with SGD is that we can't use convexity anymore, right? So this does not hold because GT is the gradient of just one random data point, right? So we cannot expect that, you know, this will hold in general, okay? But the nice thing is that this actually holds in expectation. Okay. So So in particular, GT is it turns out that GT actually is an unbiased estimate of the gradient, right? So why is that? You take the expectation of GT conditioned on XT equal to X. Okay, so given an XT, you take an expectation of GT, right? So why is this an expectation? Because for a given X, you are still picking the coordinate I at random, right? And in fact, you are picking it uniformly at random. So what it means is that every data point, right, every I in N, right, has a probability of picking which is equal to 1 by N. Okay, so you are uniformly at random picking the coordinate one over N, right? So what this means is that this particular expectation is exactly equal to 1 over N times this gradient sum, right? And this is basically this is nothing but the gradient, right? Because you kind of expand this expectation out, then every of these delta fi, or sorry, gradient of fi has a probability 1 over n, right? So the expected value just by the formula is 1 over n times this, right, which is equal to the gradient. Okay, so here, by the way, like one slight thing to keep in mind, your gradient, we are not referring to the gradient as just a sum, but we are referring to the gradient as the average. Okay, so the expected value is nothing but the average over the entire data set, right? So that's why it's an unbiased estimate of the average gradient. Any questions on this until now? Yes, go ahead.
So, Professor, is there any restriction on the data? Like, do they need to be uniformly distributed, or are there any
No.
kind of
So the only, yeah, so
restrictions?
the only, yeah, yeah. So the only assumption here in all of this, right, in ba the basic assumption of machine learning, the fact that you are having this sum of the loss functions, is that the data is IID, right? So it's, they are independent, right? So basically, like each data point is independently drawn, and they are identically distributed. Okay, so all the data points belong to one underlying distribution, and they are independent of each other. So that's the key assumption. Other than that, the distribution, they can belong to any distribution, right? And we can still basically kind of solve this using SGD, and it's still kind of it all statistically makes sense.
Got it. Thanks.
Okay, awesome. All right. So with this, I'm not going to prove this, but you can actually show this convergence bound. So by the way, I'll just talk about this result now. So this result does not hold, right? But it holds an expectation. So what it means is that you can actually write the expectation of f of xt, right, minus f of x star, right, is less than or equal to expectation of gt transpose, right, xt minus x star. Right, or maybe actually, sorry. So this is GT transpose XT minus X star, right? So essentially, the point is that this inequality holds an expectation. Okay, so that's the critical thing to keep in mind. So if we condition, so this is here, the expectation here is kind of slightly different. So here the expectation is over the t's as well, because the t's themselves are random variables. But if you condition on XT, right, then f of xt is constant. So if you condition, so the proof of this follows from this simple expression, right? So if you condition on xt, then you can basically show this, that this is nothing but expectation of gt, right, transpose conditioned on xt equal to x of xt minus x star. Okay, so essentially, for a fixed XT, if you condition on XT, then you have this, and then you can take an outer expectation where you take an expectation over the different T's as well, right? Because T's also can be treated as a random variable. So there can be different ways you can come to this T. So in all of this expectation, you have this kind of nice result. Okay. So the bound, the convergence result in general is as follows, right? So if f is convex and differentiable, so here we are not making any additional assumption, right? So it's just convex, okay? And additionally, we are assuming that the expectation of the gradient square is less than equal to b square, right? So if you recall, this is very similar to Lipschitz continuity, right? Because the Lipschitz continuity assumption was that the gradient of f at x square is less than equal to b square, right? So here, instead of taking the gradient of f, we are actually requiring that each individual stochastic gradient itself is bounded by b square. Okay. So once you make this assumption, then you use a similar step size, which is r divided by b times square root t. You get this result, right? This is something that we saw also in the case of Lipschitz continuous functions. So the bound is essentially the same, just that this is now in terms of expectation. Okay. So what is B? So capital B is the Lipschitz continuity term, right? So the way it is defined over here, B is the is like a kind of upper bound on the gradients, right? So each gradient, each stochastic gradient of each individual data point is bounded by B square. Okay. And in our standard convex analysis with like full gradient descent, we saw that B was actually the Lipschitz continuity term. Okay. So we kind of took Lipschitz continuity and then showed that the Lipschitz continuity also satisfies this relationship, right? So it's just a connection between, you know, so the B which is used in gradient descent is different from the B that we are using in HGD, right? But they have the same intuition. Okay. So this is critical. So here b square is actually the max. So this is like the max of the expectation of GT, right? So this is essentially the same as what we wrote, that each individual G T square expectation is bounded by b square. Okay. So this is what b square is. Okay. All right. Any questions until now? Okay. So we'll kind of compare and contrast gradient descent with SGD, right? In terms of the convergence, kind of convergence rates. So classical gradient descent, we assume that the gradient square as the gradient square of f, the gradient of f is bounded by b of gd, right? Sorry. So for the sum objective, right, we have this kind of nice expression here that the kind of average gradient is bounded by b of gd square, right? So this term is actually different from the B of SGD, right? So in the case of SGD, what we have is that we now have the expected square norms to be bounded by B square SGD, right? So there's a subtle difference between these two. So this is for the full gradient descent, and this is for the stochastic gradient descent, right? So essentially, this b square gd is actually less than equal to the SGD case. Okay? So the Lipschitz continuity term in SGD is slightly weaker than the full gradient descent. So this is something to keep in mind. Okay. So this can be smaller, but oftentimes they are very comparable. Okay. And in fact, if we do mini batch SGD, which we'll actually see soon. Okay. So this mini batch SGD, if you do mini batches, then actually with larger mini batches, they are actually very similar. Okay, so kind of mini batch SGD is this nice trade-off between full SGD and basically sorry, between SGD, the fully stochastic variant, and the full gradient version. Okay, so with this we'll kind of contrast some of the results we have seen so far. So you have a subgradient descent here, right? And with a subgradient descent, you have either in the convex case or the strongly convex case, So in the full gradient descent, we have order 1 over square root k for the convex case, right? And similarly, you have 1 over square root k in the convex case, right? So this is just Lipschitz continuous. So this is your Lipschitz continuous, right? And in the strongly convex case, you additionally have Lipschitz continuity plus strong convexity. Okay, so if you have this, the 1 over square root k actually goes to 1 over k. So actually you can also kind of look at this as 1 over t, right? So if you're used to 1 over t, then this is basically 1 over order 1 over square root t. This is order 1 over square root t, and this is 1 over t and 1 over t, right? So essentially what this means is that this convergence is 1 over epsilon square convergence, and this is 1 over epsilon convergence, right? So interestingly, with subgradient descent, if you don't additionally have smoothness, right, then with stochastic gradient descent, we are actually doing this n times faster, but we are getting the same convergence rate. So this is the beauty of stochastic SGD. Okay, so stochastic gradient descent or SGD, right? That you, with just capital T iterations, each iteration of full gradient descent, by the way, recall, each iteration of full gradient descent is actually n times more expensive. Okay, but still with SGD, even though we are doing n times cheaper in each iteration, after capital T iterations, we have the same convergence rate. Okay, even though with this kind of caveat that, you know, this term is actually lower than this term. So in theory, gradient descent has a slightly better convergence rate, right? But with mini batch SGD, actually a lot of that advantage goes away. Okay, so essentially we are still much faster, right? But with roughly the same kind of convergence. And actually we'll see this in practice, that our stochastic gradient descent actually does converge much faster with the right choice of the learning rate, etc. Okay. So far so good, right? Now let us assume that we have actually a gradient descent. So essentially what we are assuming is that we have smoothness here, okay? So this is convex plus smooth, and this is strongly convex plus smooth, okay? So the difference between these two cases is that here we are not, we don't require smoothness, right? We are just requiring convexity and Lipschitz continuity. And here we are additionally requiring smoothness, okay? So if we have smoothness additionally, then in the full case, we get 1 over k, right? Whereas in the stochastic case, we only have 1 over square root k. So here there's actually a difference between the two in terms of the convergence rate, right? And if you have strongly convex, then the full gradient actually gives this exponential or actually kind of linear convergence, right? Which is kind of 1 minus mu raised to L. Again, this is the condition number kappa, right? 1 minus kappa raised to k. And in the stochastic case, though, we have only a 1 over k convergence. Okay, so here there is a gap between the two. So what this means is that for smooth problems, stochastic gradient descent actually needs more iterations, right? And but still, oftentimes, even with this caveat, in practice, SGD many times is still preferable, particularly for very large data sets, because the order n complexity saving actually makes sense. You know, even though the convergence is slightly slower. Okay. So how is it faster but have the same convergence rate in the subgradient descent? So I didn't understand your question actually. So are you saying that why SGD is faster than gradient descent? Yeah. So the reason why it's faster in terms of wall clock time is because one iteration of gradient descent, right? So maybe I'll just explain this kind of to make this a little bit more. Oh, this just copied the slide. Okay, sorry. So gradient descent versus SGD, right? So gradient descent is for t equal to 1 to capital T, right? What you do is you do xt plus 1 is equal to xt minus gamma times gradient f of xt, right? Which is nothing but xt minus gamma sum of I from 1 to n gradient fi xt over n, okay, and then n for, right? But in the case of, so this is gradient descent, right? But in the case of SGD, we have for t equal to 1 to capital T, xt plus 1 is equal to xt minus gamma times gradient f. Okay, so actually, sorry, I forgot one step. So we first pick an index I in n at random, right? And then what you do is that you do basically this gamma of gradient fi, f of i, right, at xt, and then you do an n for. So this is stochastic gradient descent, right? So now do you see this, Luai, why each iteration of SGD is faster than gradient descent? Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying, right? So in the case of just convex functions where you don't have smoothness, both of them converge at the same rate, right? So essentially what this means is that f of xt minus f of x star, right, less than equal to epsilon, both of them require essentially capital T to be roughly equal to order 1 over epsilon square, for example, right? So both of them require the same number of iterations, roughly the same number of iterations to reach this epsilon bound, but each iteration of SGD is much faster. So SGD is much faster in convergence compared to gradient descent. Did I say the other way around? So sorry. So the convergence is the same rate. So the convergence rate is the same, but each iteration of SGD is much faster. So because of that, the total complexity of gradient descent, right? So the total complexity is actually going to be equal to order n over epsilon square, right? For full gradient descent. But the total complexity in the SGD case is actually just going to be order 1 over epsilon square. So it is order n times faster, okay? There's one caveat though, as I said, that here we are hiding some constants, and the constants in gradient descent will be lower than the constants in SGD, but still SGD will win, right? In at least the Lipschitz continuous case, okay? But that's not the same in the smooth case. So in the smooth case, there is a gap between the two. So in the smooth case, the full gradient descent converges at a faster rate compared to SGD, okay? But we'll actually see a few methods that actually kind of alleviate the gap, so which makes SGD kind of variant still more preferable compared to gradient descent, right? Even though there is this gap, actually we can alleviate this gap, and actually I tell you one nice trick to do this. Okay, so now we'll talk a little bit about mini batch SGD, right? So far everything that we have spoken about is just this simple SGD, right? Where we are doing one example at a time. Now, in the case of mini batches, we actually don't take a single example or a single instance, but we use a batch of these instances, right? And we take this batch and then we compute this mini batch gradient. Okay, so the batch is of size m, and then you're computing this average 1 over m sum of j from 1 to m of gt. So when m is equal to 1, you get SGD, and m is equal to n, you get full gradient descent, right? But the interesting case obviously is where m is in between. Okay. So a nice property of batch SGD is that the variance of the gradient descent, the gradient estimate, right? The variance of this estimate is actually 1 over m that of vanilla SGD. Okay. So the larger the batch size, the smaller the variance. And because the variance is small, variance actually turns out to be a very important property in the stability of the performance of SGD. Okay, so that's the reason why kind of batch SGD is a more preferred technique, right? Not just because, you know, the convergence is slightly better, but I think more importantly, the fact that the variance of this is actually lower, right? Okay, so there's also this variant, like in the non-differentiable case. So how large of a batch is large enough? Yeah, so this is a great question, actually. So oftentimes in deep learning, in deep learning, the bottleneck in the batch size actually is the memory, right? So in deep learning, the way this works is that you need to load examples into a GPU, right? So your GPU needs to have enough memory to load a batch of examples, right? And as will be like as you can see when you look at deep learning more carefully, some of the times the models are like very very deep, right? And you have a large number of parameters. So in that case, you may not even be able to load, you know, a very large batch size. So typically you load batch sizes of say 16 to 32, something like that. But in some cases, you might be able to take you might need to use a batch size of like say 4 or 8 or something like that, right? Or like sometimes even 2. So I think a lot of the batch size depends on the memory of the GPU. But having said that, you don't want your batch size to be too large as well, right? Because if your batch size becomes too large, then what happens is that your algorithm is slightly faster, but you lose the nice stochasticity of the algorithm, right? So if you have a very very large batch size, right? Say like imagine you use if your data set is of size, you know, 50,000. And you use a batch size of 10,000, right? That batch size will be too large because what will happen is that you are inherently then becoming very close to the full gradient descent regime. Okay, and we'll kind of give an intuition of why SGD is so preferred in machine learning in a few slides, right? And from that you will see that actually using a very large batch size also is not good, even from a convergence perspective, right? So that's why you want to have your batch size to be decently big, so that you're fast, because in deep learning, you can actually do a lot of tricks to make the per batch computation actually parallelized, right, or tensorized. So because you can do that, you know, the complexity of computing a batch gradient actually is very fast because of tensorization. But you know, by the same time, across batches, you know, it still needs to be done sequentially, right? So because of that, you don't want to use a too small of a batch size, because then, you know, your learning will be very slow, right? Or essentially, in other words, you know, you'll require more number of iterations. But if you have too large of a batch size, then the flip side is that you will require more you'll require more time to converge. Right? So the convergence will be poor, and sometimes even after a lot of iterations, you may not converge well, because then it starts getting into the gradient descent regime. And in fact, if there's some time toward the end, I'll point you to some papers, very recent papers actually, like this year, last year, and this year, that have been analyzing like, you know, SGD versus gradient descent for deep learning. Right? Anyways, so yeah, you're right. So actually we can kind of treat it like a hyperparameter and tune via validation. So in fact, one of the critical parameters that is tuned in hyperparameter optimization packages is actually the batch size, right? So you're right. So this is a very important parameter which can be tuned. Okay. So it turns out that asynchronous. Okay, so actually I won't be talking a lot on asynchronous SGD and like distributed SGD. Maybe I'll point you to some papers that might, towards the end, if we have some time, I can put up some papers and we can talk about it briefly, but only if we have some time. Otherwise, what I would encourage you to do is maybe, you know, someone can actually pick this as a paper to read or study, and we can actually discuss this, you know, when you're actually presenting this. But yeah, maybe if I have some time towards the end, I'll try to present some of the recent work on distributed SGD. Yeah. Okay. So for constraint problems, actually, a lot of the results carry over similar to gradient descent. I won't be talking about that. The projection is applied as usual, right? And the resulting algorithm is projective subgradient descent, or sorry, stochastic gradient descent. And again, you need the projection to be done efficiently, right? So this is a critical point, but you can kind of do projected SGD in a similar manner. Okay, so yeah, so this is the question, right? So why in machine learning, why do we prefer batch SGD to gradient descent, right? As opposed to gradient descent, right? So the cons of SGD is that in some cases, right? In some cases, so this is a caveat, right? So in some cases, we have slower convergence, right? Particularly in the case of smooth functions. The other thing is that the gradient is noisy. So we have like a high variance. So we require to do batch SGD, right? And also the kind of disadvantage here is that we are not guaranteed to reduce the objective at every iteration, okay? And there is some kind of a randomness which kind of forces you to, you know, so this is both a pro and a con, by the way, right? Because in the case of non-convex optimization in deep learning, this is actually a pro. Because of the randomness inherently, SGD is a little bit less prone to get stuck in like saddle points, right? So one more disadvantage of gradient descent in the case of deep learning is that in the case of deep learning, the contour of the you know, the objective function is filled with saddle points, right? And recall that saddle points are basically points where you have zero gradient, right? So if you just do a full gradient descent will just, you know, just declare that the gradient is zero, right? Because it's a saddle point. But the advantage of stochastic gradient descent is that you are taking the gradient now of each mini batch, right? And each mini batch may be, there is some inherent randomness, right? And the gradient of the mini batch may not actually be zero. So that way, you're not guaranteed to reduce the objective value at every iteration, but you can actually avoid saddle points kind of in a nice way with SGD, right? So that's why SGD is also beneficial for deep learning. But one kind of disadvantage here is that, you know, it's kind of much harder now to have a lot of the machinery of like learning rates, like setting the learning rates that we did in gradient descent, like the line search, etc. So it becomes much harder to do line search based logic over here. So setting the learning rate becomes very critical, right? And, you know, there have been a lot of papers as to how to set learning rates. A lot of people have been trying to, you know, do machine learning without setting learning rates, right? So to remove all hyperparameters, absolutely. And this is also a nice kind of research direction which people have been pushing at. But yeah, it's essentially learning rates is kind of a very important parameter. In fact, one of the most important parameters to set in machine learning, right? So the pros of SGD is that the per iteration cost is much cheaper compared to gradient descent. You have very fast initial convergence, right? And a mini batch gradient is actually accurate if the batch size is pretty good, right? And the data set is massive, okay? So one more key insight over here with machine learning and deep learning is that inherently what you care in machine learning is generalization, right? So you don't care about exactly minimizing the loss function that you have, okay? But you care about actually solving the problem of expectation, like expected value of f of x or like f of w, right? Where w is the parameter, okay? So you want to minimize the expected value of f of w, right? And this essentially is like the generalization loss, okay? So because you want to minimize this expected value and not necessarily the, you know, just the data set that you are given currently, stochastic gradient descent has this nice property that stochastic gradient descent actually is trying to kind of stochastically approximate this expectation. Okay, so that's part of the reason why with SGD, with SGD, you actually kind of get perform pretty well in terms of generalization, right? So oftentimes it is seen that a technique which performs better at training set can perform worse on generalization, right? And this is part of the reason is because of like overfitting. right? Or like we are trying to over-optimize the training set performance at the cost of the tests, right? And what this means is that, you know, towards the end, I'll also point out to one paper and kind of give the intuition of one paper that talks about why some of these adaptive gradient descent algorithms, right, which try to optimize the loss function exactly, perform poorly in many cases in machine learning and deep learning. And part of the reason why they do it is because they try to achieve like complex solutions, right? And they're achieving complex solutions because they are trying to, you know, exactly minimize the training loss. But this is not what you care about in deep learning, right? Or machine learning. You care about actually generalization, which is what is the intuition that SGD kind of goes with. So there's a question here that usually we could run randomized algorithms a number of times, and that could that be applied here also? It cannot, because every single model trained. Yeah, okay. So from what I understand from your question, you're trying to say that what you're trying to say is that essentially the randomized algorithms can be run multiple times and that will give you a high probability bound. You're right. That's the reason why oftentimes in deep learning, when you report accuracy numbers, you report it multiple times and take the average and compute the standard deviation, right? So it's important to understand what is the standard deviation, but in practice, when you do training, you don't very often do multiple times and pick the best or something like that, right? And the main reason for that is that even though this algorithm is randomized, the intuition, because you're doing like batch SGD and things like that, the intuition is that you still want low variance. Okay. So because you still want low variance, you know, you want to just run it once and you want to get good performance, right? But you still run it multiple times to estimate what the variance is and what the standard deviation is and what the mean performance is, etc. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So SGD kind of naturally generalizes well, and we do not care about getting the exact global minima, right? But we want to get there very quickly. So maybe we can kind of so essentially there is this kind of nice intuition with okay so before talking about the intuition, I'll just talk about some performance results of SGD, right? So what we see commonly with SGD is that SGD converges very, very quickly, very early on, right? And again, here, this is the number of data points that have been accessed, right? This is an indicator of the time, right? So because it is accessing so many data points, SGD converges very, very quickly initially, right? Initially, I mean, towards the end, it matches LBFGS. And LBFGS, by the way, is like one of the state-of-the-art algorithms, right? So LBFGS will be better than, for example, gradient descent, right? So gradient descent might have even a worse convergence here like this. So SGD even converges faster than LBFGS. And a lot of the magic here is that is because of this. Early on, it is making a lot of progress by taking one data point at a time, okay? And I try to give you one intuition of why that's the case. So think of the machine learning setting where what you really have is like you have like sum of several loss functions, right? You're taking an average loss function, and the average loss function maybe has properties like this, right? So this is the average loss function, okay? Now imagine that you're starting at a point which is very far away, okay? So you're starting at a point which is here. At this point, okay, so this is your initialization. The key intuition here is when you start, far away. This is a little bit vague what I mean by far away, but imagine, you know, just some vague term of far away, right? When you start far away, what essentially happens is that all the stochastic gradients roughly point at the same direction. Okay, so So take a point like this over here, right? You take this loss function, the gradient still points in this direction. You take this loss function, right? This loss function will be something like this. The gradient will still point in this direction. So all of them are pointing towards the minima, right? So irrespective of whether you take the full gradient or you take any of these stochastic gradients, they will all push you towards the minima, right? So they will all push you in the right direction. Now the problem is that essentially as you come closer and closer over here, that is where SGD will tend to oscillate a little bit, right? Because as you come closer, you know, some gradients might point you in the opposite direction, right? That's why instead of making progress, you can actually go in the opposite direction in the case of SGD, okay? But inherently the idea is that in expectation, because you are picking these points at random, you will still tend to make some progress, right? And eventually you will converge. But towards the end, the convergence is very slow. So the key point is, fast convergence early on, right, and slow convergence towards the end. Okay, and the intuition is that you kind of want to still have the fast convergence with SGD towards the end by invoking this kind of paradigm, right? Of so the idea is that can we still do SGD, right, but still achieve faster convergence? And there have been some directions towards this, but largely speaking, you know, this is like still a research question, right? But this is the intuition of what's going on with SGD. Okay, so maybe I'll talk about some practical aspects of SGD. Is that it's not always trivial to tune the learning rates, and that's the reason you have a lot of complex rules for learning rates, right? When the learning rate is too large, what will happen is that we can actually kind of increase the learning rate rather than decrease the learning rate. And when the learning rate is too small, the training is not only slower, but we can also permanently get stuck with a high training error, right? So if there's time to optimize only one hyperparameter, right, in SGD, then learning rate is a hyperparameter worth tuning, right? So essentially, from a practical perspective, this learning rate is a very, very important hyperparameter. And that's the reason there's a lot of push towards algorithms that, you know, have lesser and lesser hyperparameters, right? And a lot of the recent variants in deep learning that have come out, I'll talk about it a little bit in the second part, try to achieve this. Okay. So there's also learning rate schedules. You can tune the learning rate over a validation set. And with a learning rate decay, SGD is a little less sensitive to initial learning rate. Okay. So how can we improve the convergence rate of SGD, right? So in particular, we saw that the convergence rate of SGD is actually much lower than gradient descent in the smooth case, right? So the question is, can we get a much faster convergence while keeping the lower per iteration complexity, right? So we want to still have the pro of SGD, right, which is the fast per iteration complexity, and also the low per iteration complexity, right? But we also want the fast convergence rate of gradient descent. Right? So can we get the best of both worlds? So this is kind of recent effort by several learning groups that by several machine learning groups that started in 2012. But you know, there's been some research even today that has been pushing on this. The idea is that you can come up with hybrid algorithms that are in between gradient descent and SGD, right? That kind of combine both of them essentially. So the idea of the hybrid algorithm, which one such hybrid algorithm is called stochastic average gradient. Okay, and the intuition of this hybrid algorithm is that we can actually store the gradients for all I from 1 to n, right? And then we select uniformly at random this index I, and then you perform this update as follows, right? Which is xk plus 1 equal to xk minus alpha k by n yik, right? Where yik is either the stochastic gradient when I is equal to ik, or is the kind of previous gradient, right? So essentially what's going on here with the stochastic average gradient technique, right, is that it is kind of maintaining this gradient sum, right? So it's maintaining these yik's, right, for my previous iterates, and essentially for the past n iterates particularly, right? For the past n iterates. So you are still doing this average. So this, by the way, looks very similar to the average gradient. Right, but the only difference is that this average gradient, we are not actually computing the full average gradient ever. What we are doing is that we are storing this average gradient, right? We are storing this average gradient we are storing an estimate of the average gradient based on the previous stochastic gradient values, right? We are only updating this whenever I is equal to ik. But for the previous cases, we use the stale average gradient. Does it make sense? Is there any question over here? Yes, Dwayne.
What does x and y stand for?
What does x and y? Okay, so basically x is the parameter over here, right? So x is the parameter that we are updating, the optimization variable, right? So we are solving minimum x f of x. So this is the same optimization variable that we have been looking at, right? So over here, for example, we have like the way you have in gradient descent, right? So you have xk plus 1 is equal to xk minus alpha k times gradient, right? So
yes,
that's what the x is. Y's here are estimates of the gradients, okay? So essentially, I am keeping in memory this variable yi. Right, so I'm keeping in memory this variable yi for all I, right? Or let me call it yik, right? And I update this yik in this way, right? So essentially, what it means is that I update this yik to be either the gradient if I is equal to ik, otherwise I use the stale values of yi from the previous iterations from yik minus one, right? So the basic intuition here, okay, the basic intuition is that we can still only use the stochastic gradients, okay? But by using the stochastic gradients, we can actually compute this average. We are trying to imitate the full gradients by using stale values of stochastic gradients. Yes, exactly. So the idea here is that we can actually kind of reduce the variance by using stale values of stochastic gradient, and this actually turns out to be sufficient. So is there an initial value of yi? Yeah, so we start with initially say yi equal to zero, right? But as you do like n iterations, you would essentially set at some point you would set this to be the gradient value, right? And once it is set, then you actually kind of continue resetting it every time you get this particular I in the iteration, right? So it's using stale values of previous stochastic gradients. It's using stale values of previous stochastic gradients and trying to approximate this. But the advantage is that you don't need to naively compute this in this way, right? You can actually compute this more efficiently. And I'm not going to do the math, right? But you can imagine that this term is like, let's call this term yk, right? You can compute yk, I guess, efficiently by doing yk is equal to yk minus 1, right, minus alpha k by n times gradient f of ik times xk, right, sorry, plus of this minus yik times k minus 1. Is this clear to everyone? Why this holds? Why this updates holds, this update holds of yk. Yeah, exactly. So this is the running average, right? So this is the running average of this so far. And then I'm just updating the running average in this way. Okay. The critical thing though is that I need to be able to store the values of yik, right? I need to store the values of yik for every k, right? So I'm increasing this in memory, right? So my memory is increasing, my memory requirement is increasing. So there's a storage overhead over here, right? But this is acceptable in certain settings. Okay. And the other thing actually, which, you know, has been shown in this paper, I won't go over it, but actually it is sufficient to just store the values of X transpose AI, because this particular stochastic gradient, right, just depends on X transpose AI. So would this averaging hurt the convergence rate? So actually, no. So in fact, interestingly, it turns to improve the convergence rate over gradient descent, right? And the most important reason why it improves this convergence rate, so it's not gradient descent in comparison to stochastic gradient descent, right? And the most important reason why it does this is that it does it because it is bringing in this stability, right? So essentially the main takeaway from this paper, from the theoretical analysis, which is like very, very kind of nasty, right? So I mean, I'm not going to go over the theory. Like, I would encourage you to go over this paper, which is 2012 NIPS paper, NeurIPS paper, 2012, that talks about this technique, right? But the main intuition or the takeaway here is that even though we are using the stale gradients and averaging it out, those stale gradients are not too bad, right? We don't need to recompute the gradients every time. We can use slightly stale gradients, but those still have more information, right? So because we are taking this averaging, we are still using more information of previous stale gradients, and that is what is helping the convergence rate basically. At what point? Yeah, so this is a hybrid in the sense that we are using something like the full gradient. We are not exactly using the full gradient. Okay. So by the way, there is one more variant over here, which I'll just briefly mention. I don't remember exactly which one this is, but there is actually one variant that actually uses the full gradient once in a while, right? So that's also a hybrid algorithm. And the idea is that for most of the iterations, you just use a stochastic gradient, but every once in a while, you compute a full gradient, right? And then use that as well. And I think there also, you know, that also has been shown to improve the performance, right? But I think mostly we will study just stochastic average gradient right now. So in the case of strongly convex, for example, right? Stochastic gradient descent actually gets this improved convergence bound of, you know, this kind of raised to k, right? So again, the constants are slightly worse. There is this mu over n, 1 over 8n. So again, there's like some kind of weird constants over here, but it suffices to say that this is also kind of linear convergence, right? Okay. The convergence analysis is very complicated, so I won't even attempt to talk about it. But if you're interested, you know, feel free to go over that paper. You know, I think it'll be a good read to understand what's going on in this space. There have been several follow-up papers, you know, Shai-Shalev Schwartz and Zhang, Johnson and Zhang. There's one called Stochastic Dual Coordinate, SDCA. There's one called Stochastic Variance Reduced Gradient, right, SVRG. There's a proximal SVRG. There's a hybrid of SAG and SVRG called SAGA. And then there's like, you know, kind of accelerated versions of this, asynchronous versions of this, in the kind of extensions of this to like Nesterov's method, sorry, Newton's method, not Nesterov, sorry, Newton's method, like incremental Newton's method, et cetera, right? So there's a long list of papers here which all study this setting, okay? And, so do all assumptions here also have Lipschitz continuous? So in just the Lipschitz continuous case, right, if you recall, SGD is good enough, right? So if you just have Lipschitz continuity or Lipschitz continuity plus strong convexity, then SGD is good enough. You don't require any of these more fancy algorithms from a convergence perspective, right? Do you guys recall that? So this is what we spoke over here, right? So essentially, The main difference comes, so this is the key, right? So over here, in the subgradient world, right, where you just have convex and strongly convex with Lipschitz continuity, right, both of these match, right? The case where there's a difference is these two, which is a smooth case and a strongly convex case, right? And this is a smooth case, and smooth plus strongly convex. And this is where actually, you know, the averaging algorithms actually tend to perform better, and they have better convergence rates. And that's the realm where we are interested, where you know these papers are coming from. Okay. Any other questions? Right. So this is the performance of, I think, like in the case of, I think, logistic regression. Right. So you have LBFGS, right? And LBFGS has very fast convergence, but actually SAG has even faster convergence, right? So yeah, there's just some empirical results. Again, this is from their paper. Basically, I think the paper is Lerow, Schmidt, and Bach, 2012, right? So this is the stochastic average gradient paper, right? All right. So I think we'll end the first part and we'll take a quick break. So there's a question here, is it possible to use LBFGS or say some other algorithms from the point of where HDD starts oscillating? Yeah, so that's a good question. I think this can all be done empirically, right? From a theoretical perspective though, you know, people have not analyzed this, or I don't think whether this can be analyzed or not. The second part I want to mention, Parth, is that the realm where LBFGS makes sense is actually different from the realm where HDD makes sense, right? So in the world where you want to use HDD, LBFGS would be very hard to even run, right? Because LBFGS is even more than gradient descent, right? So gradient descent itself requires, you know, requires running the computer full gradient, and LBFGS requires computing the previous L gradients, right? And this is like in a massive data set case, this is something that will not be feasible, right? Or will be very slow. So at that realm, kind of comparing with LBFGS does not really make sense anymore. I think like HDD will beat it by orders of magnitude. Even though SG is oscillating a little bit, right, it'll still be much faster than LBFGS. Yeah.
So I just want to make sure, was there any difference in the convergence rates for a mini batch SGD versus just regular SGD?
Yeah.
Were they the same?
No, there's actually no difference. There's no difference. The convergence rates all hold with mini batch SGD, just that mini batch SGD is from an empirical perspective, you know, much better to use in practice than SGD, right? But in terms of the worst case convergence rates, as far as I am aware, the rates are pretty much the same.
Okay.
Right. So just doing mini batch HDD, for example, does not magically improve the convergence bounds, from what I'm aware. I might be missing some papers because, you know, this is a very active research area, obviously. But from what I'm aware, I don't think there is. Okay. All right, so with this, I think we'll end this lecture 6.1. Next, we'll actually look at, you know, some of the applications of HDD to deep learning. And, you know, a lot of the convergence rates don't hold anymore, but it's still good to understand what's going on here. And we'll look at this family of algorithms, right? Basically, vanilla HDD, momentum variants, and heavy ball variants, Nesterov's versions of this. And adaptive methods, right? Like ADAM, ADAGRAD, RMS prop, etc. So we look at some of these, and then I'll also point out to some papers that are actually interesting here. Okay. So why don't we take a few minutes break, like maybe a five minute break, or actually maybe a 7 minute break, right? And why don't we meet at 1:30? Okay.